We're going to begin by hearing from Max Rosa, who is going to give a talk on the big picture history of international development, both in the developed and the developing world, over the last 200 years. And the hope with the talk is that by realizing how radically living conditions have improved across the world, this might give us, as effective altruists, more optimism for the possibility of doing the same for parts of the developing world today. Max Rosa is an economist working at the University of Oxford. His research interest is the long-term evolution of living standards around the world. In addition to his research, he's trying to communicate his empirical research via visualizations on our world in data.org. The publication tells the social, economic, and environmental history of the world up to the present day, based on empirical data and visualized in interactive graphs and maps. So, without further ado, please join me in giving a very warm welcome for Max Rosa.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Jacob. Does the microphone work? Does everyone hear me in the back? Thumbs up at the back. Great. Good morning, everybody. Great that so many people came out so very early on a Sunday morning, earlier than church, I guess. I'll present the history of development, but I want to be a bit more narrow and speak mostly about extreme poverty, which is also one of my core research interests here at the university, where I work as an economist, partly at Nuffield College, at the Oxford Martin School, and at this Institute for New Economic Thinking. So extreme poverty will be in the center of it, but I thought I'd also add one more topic, kind of forward-looking, which most of my historical research doesn't do, and I want to talk a bit about migration in the end. And these slides that I present, they're basically just a website, and I'll make them available afterwards so that you can look through them again if you want and share them. So as Jacob was saying, As Jacob was saying, I'm publishing this web publication called Our World in Data, and I embedded it here in this slide. So the idea of this web publication is really to give a very big picture overview of how the world is changing and how each aspect that people care about in the world changed over the last decades, centuries. Sometimes we have insights of how living standards changed really over millennia. And it's split up into these different categories and then different entries. So you find research on population, aspects like fertility or population growth, life expectancy. You find research on health, like malaria, life expectancy, suicides. You find research on food, energy, technology, growth and inequality, more my own research fields. You find research on happiness, on the public sector aspects, like how is healthcare financed. You find research on war and peace, how is violence changing over the long run, and what's the big picture today. A big field that we are working on right now is education. You can check it out for yourself at ourworldindata.org. And all of the material that I'm presenting today is part of this publication. I started doing this work something like 5 years ago now. Was mostly like a side project. Now, over the last year, it became like the core of my research. So probably 60% or so of my time is now spent on this publication. And I have these great colleagues that I want to introduce quickly. It's Jaden Misby, a web developer who's based in Perth in Australia, and Esteban Ortiz-Ospina, an economist here from Oxford, who's now based in Quito. So it's the three of us that are working on this publication. This first data visualization here shows you the reduction of extreme poverty in countries that are rich today. So it's the same measure of extreme poverty that we're using today. It was once $1 per day, and it was then adjusted in the succeeding rounds to $1.25 per day until last October, and this is data from 2 years ago. So it's still this extreme poverty measure of $1.25 per day, and then reconstructed for today's rich world. So we see the estimates for the 19th century, for the US, for Italy, Japan, and I included this and show these high levels of extreme poverty in countries that are very rich today to make this point that we shouldn't forget how recent the experience of extreme poverty was really like the experience of everyone in the countries that are so very rich today. Like 40, 50, 60% of the people just a couple of generations ago lived in conditions that we would label as extremely poor today. That is taking into account also subsistence farmers and people who didn't have monetary income, and it's looking at the consumption level. So it's really a very recent phenomenon. And I think like this is also a point why that I'm always trying to do at Our World in Data, because if you go to the World Bank and the UN as data sources, then you get this last bit there to the right, right? Like you get this change from 1950, 1960, 1970 onwards for extreme poverty, really only 1980 onwards. So I'm trying to combine the research from economic historians, social historians that reconstruct this long time series before, because otherwise it's easy to make the mistake and think that there was always this rich world here that was always well off, and there was always this poor world down there where people lived in misery always, and this is a static world that will never change. And only if you add these 100 years to the big picture, you see that the same misery that we see in many parts of the world, unfortunately still today, was around just outside the door a couple of generations ago. This very rapid increase of prosperity in the Western world led to a tremendous increase in global inequality. This chart shows you the income distribution of the world, or reconstructions of the income distribution in 1800 and then 1970 in blue. And you see that in 1820, the world was, the inequality was low, and the prosperity level was also low. So most people lived in extreme poverty. In 1970, we then had this very clearly divided world with the richer world here to the right, and split up from that, a poorer world to the left. For the last three decades, we have better data that I want to show and present how the global income distribution has changed. It's the same chart. On the x-axis, you see yearly income per person from $100, $1,000, $10,000, and then cut off over $40,000. In 1988, you see the rich countries, the developed countries, the OECD countries to the right, and then to the left, much of sub-Saharan Africa, Asia, India, and China, and then Latin America and the Eastern European countries in the middle of that. Let's see how that has changed over the last three decades. This is 1993. This is 1998. You see how the distribution moves to the right. You see how China really overtakes there. And this is the very latest data, where China really crept over India, caught up with the with the rich world, and where the whole distribution moved to the right. So this era of increasing inequality in the world, which lasted for at least 200 years, really came to an end over this period. And since the mid-late 1990s, global income inequality is falling, and now the incomes of poor people are on average rising faster than the incomes of rich people. So global income inequality followed this trend of a long rise, and now is at a very high level, but is coming down. Another aspect that you could see in this visualization was how the distribution moved to the right. It means that the people are moving out of poverty, and if we just focus on this poverty history, you see the last 200 years in this long slide, the share of the world population living in absolute or extreme poverty. The black data is from the World Bank. That's like all of this data comes with some uncertainty, but it's quite good data based on household surveys. We see that in 1981, 44% of the world population lived in extreme poverty. This yellow time series up there are reconstructions from economic historians. And it's difficult to compare income levels over such a long period, but you see that by any reasonable standard, 80, 90% of the world population lived in extreme poverty in the 19th century. And then as more world regions started to increase productivity and industrialized, incomes grew in more and more parts of the world, and as a share, poverty came down over the last 200 years, and then we saw this very rapid decrease over the last three decades. And the latest data are projections for 2015, where the World Bank estimates that just below 10%, 9.6% live in extreme poverty. This is the same data, but you can switch it to the absolute number, because people always ask me about that. So that's the absolute number of people living in extreme poverty in red and living outside of extreme poverty in green. We see that for the longest period, the decline in poverty was not fast enough to counterbalance the increase of the world population. But since the 1970s or so, the absolute number of people in extreme poverty is also falling. One motivation for doing all of this and for making it freely available, making it open source on the web and trying to get it as much out as I can is that people really don't know about global development. So this is from a recent survey where people were asked to complete this sentence: in the last 30 years, the proportion of the world population living in extreme poverty has, and then more than half think it has increased, a third think that it has remained more or less the same, and only 12% of the people know that it has decreased. This is data from the UK. It's worse in some other countries, but it's also really nothing to be proud of in the UK, especially if you consider that this is the subsample of the survey where people with a university degree were asked. And I think partly because people don't know about global development, people are very pessimistic. These are the results from another survey in which adults were asked, all things considered, do you think the world is getting better or worse, or neither getting better nor worse? In some countries in which the global, in which economic growth is happening very rapidly, people are somewhat optimistic, but in most countries, people are very, very pessimistic. Back home in Germany, only 4% think that the world is getting a better place. And I think that's just wrong. And I think partly, psychology, human psychology is part of it, but it's also journalism, and I just like that quote, which really sums up my motivation for that, from Albert Schweitzer, who said, the journalism of today, and that was 50 years ago, worries me. The emphasis on negative events is too strong. Quite often, the news about events that represent real progress are overlooked and trivialized. The press tends to create a negative, discouraging atmosphere. There is a danger that people will lose faith in progress when they hear so little that would support their faith in it. And real progress is closely linked to the faith of a society who considers this progress possible. I think that is right, and I think that's one reason why we should get more information about global development out there. So that was kind of the bit that was within the realms of what I'm doing in Our World in Data, giving this long-term perspective, presenting a bit about the motivation. But I want to look ahead, as I said in the introduction, and look at world poverty today and what the future could possibly look for world poverty. The big picture of today is this. It's still 746 million living in extreme poverty in the latest data from 2013. We saw this long decline. 10% is an amazing achievement over the last 200 years. But the point is always that we have to do more, and is never to be complacent and sit back and consider the job done. 750 million are still living in extreme poverty. Country with most people in poverty is India, with 218 million. The continent with most people in extreme poverty is Africa, with almost 400 million. I saw this at some effective altruism website recently, this quote, and I liked it. The mark of a civilized human is the ability to look at a column of numbers and weep. I think that sums it up. I think that sums up this connection between effective altruism and this kind of big picture global development research that I'm doing. It's attributed to Bertrand Russell. If you Google the quote, then you find this effective altruism blog where they discuss whether it was Russell or not. But these numbers that we see in the world, they are still very much numbers where we should weep. Let's look at the global income distribution today, because that will tell us something about what is possible for the future. We see the income for each position in the global distribution for both 2003 and 2013. In blue, you see the position, the income at each position in 2013. So if we go to the 50% line here, this is the median income in the world, which is in 2013 just over 2,000 international dollars. These international dollars are adjusted both for price changes over time, like inflation, and price differences between countries. Median income was $2,000 10 years before. It was just over $1,000, so median income doubled almost over the last 10 years, a tremendous achievement that very few people know. But at the same time, we see that the inequality in the world is still very huge. To be part of the top 10% in the world, you had to have an income of 14,500 international dollars. To be part of the bottom 10%, the income cutoff was $460. So it's almost, it's more, the ratio between the top 10 and the bottom 10 is 30. We see the same picture here, that inequality fell, by the way, for the 2003 data, the ratio between the bottom and the top 10% was almost 38. But still, the inequality is very high, and if we don't plot it on a logarithmic scale, the incomes, but plot it on a linear scale, it becomes even more clear just how huge global inequality really is. One question that we might be interested in if we want to see the future of global prosperity is, how long does it reasonably take for someone who is now at the 10% cutoff to get to the 90% cutoff, right? Like, how long does it take from $480 to $14,500? These are the numbers here. With a growth rate of 2%, it will take you 172 years. 2% is the average growth rate that we saw in the US or in rich countries around the world. Like, on the long run, growth in the US and in today's rich countries never really exceeded 2%. So that would mean 172 people until people are at an income at 14,500, which for most rich countries is still very low income. It is possible for countries who are catching up to have a higher growth rates, 4%, 6%, but even then it takes you almost 90, almost 60 years to get from the bottom 10% to the top 10%. So I think we, like the effective altruists, will be around, or should be around, for a very long time. We can compare this with growth in Africa today, and not many countries really have a growth rate of over 4%. This is the average over the last 20 years. It looked much worse in the period before 1995. But even today, most African countries have these growth rates that will keep us here for a couple of decades. The last bit I want to talk about is migration. And there, one research finding that I would like to point out is the relationship between the income in the origin country of emigrants and the probability of, or the likelihood of leaving that country. Because I think there is this widespread rumor that people leave countries when the incomes in the origin countries are very low, and as development happens and incomes increase in the poorest countries, people have less of a incentive or a wish to leave their home country, but the research really doesn't show that. You see on the x-axis the income in the origin country from 500 on a logarithmic scale again to 5,000 to 50,000, and then on the y-axis the emigrant stock over the population of the origin country. And for the very poor countries, people just don't leave. And the likelihood then increases as incomes increase, and it's the somewhere on the middle of this spectrum, these countries are the countries where people leave their home and move to another place. These estimates are shown here for 5 decades, and that picture really didn't change. It was in 1960s, in the 1970s, in the 1980s, in the 1990s, in the 2000s. It was always the same. People from very poor countries, they lack the means, they lack the information. It's also education that matters for that. They lack the networks, and they don't leave. And it's the country, the people in, of the kind of mid-income range that leave. If we go back to the income distribution, that's the same measure. We see that an income of 5,000, where this curve just peaked, is relatively high in the global income distribution. And really, the bulk of the global population lives in places to the lives on incomes that are to the left of this peak. So, I think if the last 5 decades are a guide for what we can expect today or in the future, then higher migration will be something that we have to get used to and have to handle in some way. And I think it's actually it has actually fantastic potential, and maybe potential for effective altruists. That's why I included in this talk. Maybe it's a place to find gold in the way that Owen was saying yesterday. And I want to make this comparison with anti-poverty programs. These are the results from a multifaceted anti-poverty program. It was multifaceted in the way that it had 6 elements. People were given a productive asset transfer, got consumption support, got technical skills training, got high-frequency home visits, a savings program was part of it, and some health education was part of it. That's a study that was done by the J-PAL people, Banerjee and Duflo and others. And they did this study in all of these countries, plus Honduras, which fails, so it's not part of their of this final sample. But they did it in Ethiopia, India, Pakistan, Ghana, and Peru. And the light blue bar here to the left is the treatment effect of the poverty program on non-durable consumptions in the year 3 after the end of that program. And you find that on average, consumption increased by, on average, $344. That's a huge success. People who are familiar with programs on against poverty know that it's really not easy. So that was a huge success. The paper is published in Science. The dark blue now looks at the net present value of that. They assumed a depreciation of or a discounting of 5%, and they're taking into account the costs of the program, and then on average, the net present value is something like $4,000 for such an anti-poverty program, the most successful program evaluated with the very best people in that field. That's what we can reasonably expect for this anti-poverty program. Now, Lan Pritchard, a migration researcher, compared that with the benefits of migration, and that looks like that. We have to first rescale the y-axis to actually fit it on, and then the numbers look like this. These green numbers now are the lower bound estimates of the annual wage gain of low-skilled male workers moving to the US. So we are now comparing the net present value over for these programs, so what we can expect over the lifetime of these programs, which are around $4,000, with the annual gain from migration. Migration is really a fantastic way to reduce poverty, to give people the chance to move from low productivity environments to high productivity environments, even for low-skilled workers, is something that boosts incomes just tremendously. I think that I'm not sure how much that is discussed in effective altruism. I read a bit about it, but I think the scale of this intervention, if you will, is really something that should make it worthwhile to consider. If you aggregate the effects of migration, then you get the following picture. This is now looking at the projected annual gains from removing international barriers, and I'll show you the data for removing trade and for removing barriers to capital flows, and that is as a share of global GDP. So this is from different sources, and removing barriers to global trade gets global GDP increased by something between 0.3%, according to these two authors, to up to 4%, according to these authors. And removing barriers to global capital flows is probably a bit has a bit of a smaller effect. How does that compare with the benefits of removing international barriers for labor migration? There you go. It's now rescaled here to the bottom, and you see on the right the estimates for the benefits of removing international borders. Three different authors, 67% the lowest estimate, 122% the highest estimates, and that's as a share of global GDP. So removing the, it comes with huge uncertainty, no doubt about this, but this is the best data that is out there. But removing the barriers to labor mobility is somewhere in the realm of doubling global GDP. I think it's definitely some gold mine to consider. If you don't know about what I'm talking with this gold mine, then maybe you missed the opening session yesterday. And of course, this also has distributional effects, and the highest gains that you can expect for them for reducing labor barriers is, of course, to the poorer people in the world, like the Swiss people won't benefit much from reducing that. As we come to an end, I just wanted to make this point, like, it's kind of obvious that the big hurdle here is that people are not really in favor of allowing more immigration here. This is looking at the most important issues according to Brexit supporters and according to Remain supporters. Remain supporters don't have a big issue with immigration. Less than 5% think that it's the most important issues. Brexit supporters very much have a problem with more immigration. 40% think that it is the most important issue. The same picture for Trump supporters, where poverty or inequality is something that matters to all, but immigration really matters to the people who have a favorable view of Donald Trump. So in this sense, it's a effective altruism cause that is, I think, very different from other causes. It's not a technical solution that has to be implemented, but it's really this political hurdle back here, like outside of your door, that needs to get fixed if you think that this is a good way forward. I just wanted to add this to the conversation. You find all of this research on Our World in Data. On my Twitter thing, I share these slides so that you can access them there, or you just send me an email. You find my email address on the website, and then I can send you the link as well. Thank you very much.